Hello everyone, welcome back. Smothered Run here once again with another Shogun 2 multiplayer avatar battle. This is a 2v2. Just from the battle list, we created a battle and said, hey, come join us and play. I'm playing with Triple Z Hacker on my side. Say hi, Triple Z.
Hello, everyone.
Why don't you describe? I always like your descriptions of the map, so why don't you start and tell us where we are?
Sure thing. So, this is Smothered Run's favorite map. We're on Forest Gully.
Yes, it is.
And this map is the terrain and the amount of like woods and everything provide lots of different strategies here, but we'll go over the dojos first. So in front of my army on my side, I got this archery dojo. And then in the middle of the map, we have the sword dojo. And the last key building on the far side, the left side of the map, is the shrine in front of Smothered Run's army.
Why don't we talk about what did you bring? What kind of army did you bring this time?
Yeah, I brought a pretty balanced army. And so I have just a about, I believe it's three Yari cav, a light cav hidden in the woods right there. And then I have my one missile unit is my Daikyu Samurai. Just a pretty good it's my favorite missile unit. And then I have
It is kick ass. It is kick
they have a
ass.
lot of range and rank them up a lot. And then I have two Naginata attendants just as extra fodder in case of guns. I have a Yari Samurai, obviously, to capture key buildings. I use them pretty much how Smothered Run uses his as well. And then I have three Naginata attendant. I mean, sorry, three Naginata Samurai, and then three Naginata Warrior Monks. So for the Warcry bonus and the Naginata Samurai, just a tank as a frontline unit to go along with my general, of course.
Nice, and yours is a leadership general with some good buffs to melee. And then I brought my standard sort of katana core idea that I like to use. So I have, I guess I'll start with cavalry for fun. I've got my some two. I've got some of my favorite units here. I've got light
The light
cavalry.
cav special.
Yeah, the light cav special. I have five of them. It looks like, yeah, five light cavalry. I have one matchlock Ashigaru along to go along with one Yari Ashigaru. They're put together in a group. And then I've got for just for the fun of it, I've got Benkai's blades, Naginata attendants just for fodder and screening. I've got a Yari samurai for building capture and anti-cavalry, as well as do I have one more? No, that's the only anti-cavalry unit I have. Then I have five Katana Samurai. Looks like, yeah, Katana Samurai. Most of them are vets. One of them's fresh, just because I couldn't afford to bring another veteran. And then I've got two. Nope. Do I only have one? Yeah, it looks like I only have one Bow Samurai. Oh no, I do have two Yari Samurai. Look at that. I have two Yari Samurai. Yeah, like you said, this is my favorite map just because of the amount of the different things you can do with the woods. Sometimes I like to do sort of a big claw and a little claw and put the little claw of my army inside the trees and then sort of march them as close as I can to the enemy. Usually this is my favorite where this where Foxhounder here is usually my favorite spot to deploy because you get so much closer to the other building through that tree line before you're seen. And we're facing. I'll start with the guys right across from me here. We have Mr. Platypus with Yari Samurai, Yari Samurai, Yari Samurai. We have two katana, three katana, four, five katana samurai. So a player after my own heart, I suppose. Three matchlock Ashigaru, two Bow Ashigaru. This is an interesting deployment, by the way. Four Bow Ashigaru and a bow general with a little bit of melee and one Yari Cav. Over here with Foxhounder, we have Yari Ashigaru, Yari Ashigaru, Naginata Attendant, I think. No, Yari Samurai. Foot Samurai, Foot Samurai, Foot Samurai. So three foot samurais, which are a pretty decent bow unit, hey? A couple.
Yeah, the way Foxhounder upgraded his army, he's got some Nodachis there and then some more Naginatas In the rear as well, but the way he upgraded those foot samurai, I mean, their reload is I think 70 and their accuracy is 70.
Holy shit.
Just their range is just so small, but if he can get them into you know, close enough, they can maybe get a few powerful volleys off and maybe even quick volleys at that.
Yeah, well, let's clarify short range compared to our Daikus. Your Daikus have a range of 200, my bow samurai and his foot samurai all have a range of the standard 150. So
yeah. It's so, range is a big factor when it comes to missile units, but yeah, that's certainly true.
So I'm just gonna start the battle here. We're both pushing forward because we're gonna try to get that sword dojo, and for the lulz, I think you're gonna try to get that archery dojo too.
Yeah, I may as well, since it's right in front of me, and I really don't want them to have it, considering we're fighting two hybrid missile cores, is what I would call them.
Yeah.
You know, mainly. I mean, I know that Mr. Platypus has all those katanas, but with so much Boa Shigaru in the matchlocks, too, it's really hard to say what exactly that build is, so I would call it like a hybrid katana missile core.
Yeah. And if used correctly, that... this one here that Platypus has would be very deadly. And as it is, it was just this Foxhounders was just difficult to attack just because of the sheer number of bows and their reload speed, hey?
Yeah, also the terrain, and again, like you mentioned, that position being good for hiding things in the woods, it's really not advantageous to just charge up the hill to attack bows or any, you know, with spears so close to them. And as you can see, we get some early cav going. Yeah.
Suicide cav charge, and this is why I love light cavalry. He's gonna actually hit two units there.
Yeah, really nice spread out there. Like, for someone who doesn't say they use cavalry really well, this is an excellent charge. And for those of you watching, really, like, Smothered Drone's charge right here is a prime example of how to really use cavalry effectively against infantry.
Yeah, especially light or Yari cav. The thing you don't want to do is leave them in melee, because they suck. Their melee attack is 4 and their defense is 1, but a quick charge in. I love doing suicide cav charges, especially with light cav, just because they cause so much damage. Like, these guys lost 30 men almost. These guys lost, like, what, 20? Almost 20? So, and this unit still adds just over 3/4 strength, so I'll take that any day. That's a fair trade for me.
Yeah.
Especially cost-wise.
Yeah, exactly.
So, and again, so since my opponent didn't put any spears to protect those swords, guess who's getting round two?
Right. And that was a huge part of this battle, was the early cav engagement really being crucial for us. I mean, again, Foxhounder has no cavalry, and you know, Mr. Platypus, is the way he spaced his units out, they're so far apart from each other, it's really difficult for them to support.
And they're moving! And the missile units are moving! Does get a few, but I do get into his matchlocks.
Yeah, if anything, it just forces Mr. Platypus to commit certain areas, and as you can see, him committing his cavalry there opened up the possibility for my cavalry to get involved over here.
And here they come. And you're gonna do the same thing.
Yeah, and I send some up there to go deal with another missile unit moving. I think those are Portuguese Tersos. Or I eventually go over there and deal with them.
Yep.
But yeah, here again, just some Yari cav, and I have mine in loose formation, which isn't really good, but I kept them in loose formation in case, you know, the archers or I took any missile fire. So, but yeah, again, just pretty much your suicide cav charge, and this is, 2v2s are so crucial in helping your teammates as many ways as you can.
Here we go, cavalry in behind, getting into the bows over here, into the swords over here, like... You know, I love a good stand-up infantry fight, but if I can use cavalry effectively early on, I mean, I always like keeping cavalry in reserve, but I mean, this unit's down almost half strength. This unit's down almost half strength too, and you're fine. You only lost a few Yari cav in that charge.
Yeah, I mean, it's again, you gotta protect your missile units. And if you have enough cavalry to get a charge in on missile units, and then also, you know, fight enemy cav at the same time, that's always a bonus.
Yeah. And of course over here, just gonna zoom over here quick. So I've lost one unit of light cav over here, but I've managed to get into his matchlocks. I've managed to hit, I don't know if I hit this bow, but I hit this bow here, I think. Yeah. And this cavalry's tied down and getting shot at too by his own bows, tying into these.
And, yeah.
At this point, I'm perfectly happy to just, I mean, I still have three or four units of cavalry left over. I'm perfectly happy to poop those out one at a time, two at a time. And
our men are running from the battlefield.
Your
shameful display.
I think your Daikus are almost ready to start engaging his units here, hey, because he's got lots of Ashigaru.
Yeah, that was the thing is with the Daikus, I could get the range, so it kind of, you know, had he had Foxhound or maybe had Bow Samurai or maybe even just a Bow Warrior Monk, the terrain would make all the difference. But since my Daikus have such long range, it really didn't matter. I mean, I was hoping to, you know, just, you know, take that hill, but there was no chance. So I just let my Daikus do most of the work and stayed far enough back to where those Foot Samurai couldn't get close enough, really. Yeah. And if you can use your bows to hit Ashigaru, the less armored units, the better.
Yep. Shooting at high value, like shooting at heavy armor like Naginata Samurai, not always the best. Or hero units.
Yeah.
But
oh yeah.
So here's a bit of a mistake, and I'm going to take advantage of it. My opponent's bows are all the way in the back. Now that I've decimated some of his units of bows, he's leaving his infantry, which is arguably going to win him the battle because it's going should be pinning me down, and then he should be hitting me with all his missile units. He's got his Yari Samurai out in the open here, perfect shot for my bows. So I'm perfectly happy to. You've got more cavalry flanking around. That's right. I'm perfectly happy to bring my bows up and start shooting into his infantry. I will do this until I run out of arrows. I think I do.
Yes, you do. And I have the Archie Dojo in case for you to reload them, but eventually you don't even need them to reload. But yeah, I mean, again, you know, you're taking advantage of the terrain, and since you have those missile units up front, you're able to. And I mean, these Foot Samurai do end up actually hitting a few of my Daikus, but, you know, and they actually do have about the same, if not, maybe the Foot Samurai have more armor, I think. So I end up pulling back.
They have six.
Yeah, it's a crazy unit. But I send my cav over there to help smother Drun because, you know, in a 2v2, you want to help your teammates as much as possible. And one of the biggest things is, like, if I don't have the terrain advantage on my side, I don't really need to engage. Yep. So I'll just engage with whatever forces I can. And if I can, you know, help my teammate beat, you know, their opponent that they're facing off sooner, the more likely my teammate will be able to come over and help me to win the battle later.
Exactly. You know, teamwork is key. And sometimes the teamwork means you have to sacrifice almost your entire army to hold down two guys while you take on one person.
Right. It requires a lot of, like, I mean, just, you know, strategy games in general requires a lot of patience and a lot of, you know, decision making, and it's problem solving, you know.
Yep.
It's a lot of problem solving. And so, you know, here one of the biggest things is, you know, there's a lot of problem solving going on in Smother Drone's thinking in terms of, you know, I don't really need the shrine at this moment, I don't need to engage, I'll just let my bows, you know, and be patient and hammer away. And well, Mr. Platypus didn't adjust well to dealing with that.
Exactly.
And that's one of the biggest things is, you know, the in battle adjustments on the fly in the moment is what makes it really, like, such a good strategy game.
Here you go, you're sending, now that your Yari Samurai have basically done what they need to, because there's no cavalry here for Foxhounder. So hey, what are Yari Samurai good for? They're good for moving quickly. And they have a bit
of
armor.
I just figured I'd just send them up the hill to scare away some of those Foot Samurai, you know. I just really want to prevent him from perching up on that little cliff right there to overlook the dojo. Kind of like how you're doing on the other side, but I'm trying to prevent Foxhounder from doing the same to me. And that's, again, one of the things that, you know, Mr. Platypus doesn't really take advantage of until much later in the battle, I think. Yeah. Or, you know, doesn't really make their move until later.
And this was I think this was crucial because you've now pushed his units back, and despite their cost being regular, I think these are veterans too, like despite their cost being about 720 koku with the trade post, these are now one of your least expensive units as far as value to the battle, because there's no cavalry really to speak of other than this one unit. So all of a sudden, them plus your Naginata attendants have become a great screen against all of the missile units that both of our opponents have. So
I think that's
why I usually bring like Naginata attendants or sword attendants, but I prefer Naginata attendants because they have more armor. But that's where being prepared to sacrifice units when necessary is a very important tactic, especially even a unit as expensive as Yari Samurai, using them as a screen once they've outlived their purpose, in which case in this battle was grab a dojo and just pretend like you're warding off cavalry, basically. And they've basically, now their usefulness as far as the engagements are going to be is next to none, which is perfectly fine.
Right.
And you're going to use them to your advantage for screening. These match selects are now reloading, so perfect time to charge them.
Yeah, and they also start running, which is even a better time too. And I mean, that's kind of the thing is, for me, I usually bring Yari cavalry, because they're anti-cav units. And if you can, use your anti-cav units, or use your cavalry to kill the opponent's cavalry, then those Yari samurai and Naginata attendants become just meat shields, fodder, as you say. And the other thing that's really good, and is they can tie down enemy opponents. I mean, unless they have, such a, really good charge with no dashis, they're not going to be able to cut through them quickly enough. They're going to have to, still kill some of them. So, but yeah, again, really good by you there, Smother Drone, to just bring those archers back to really make those matchlocks have a poor angle of shooting up that hill and giving my cavalry enough time to charge in there to maybe just threaten them away, kind of,
Because that volley from the matchlocks killed 9. And I was perfectly happy to let him shoot. And, I suppose I could have run my units once they ran out of ammo. I could have run them over to the archery dojo here on the other side of the map to reload and then come all the way back. But normally I like attacking right away, but this battle here, I figured with all those missile units and the fact that he had them so far back, I'll just sit up on this hill. And it is kind of camping, but I think this is more skirmishing, because I'm just going to press in. I have an advantage, despite the lack of numbers of missiles for both of us. We're using the missile advantage. You have the range on your opponent, and I just have the physical desire to put my bows out in front and just pick away at his infantry, so my infantry has less bodies to cut through in order to get to his missiles.
It's the utilization, really. And yeah, it's definitely not camping, considering it's a 2v2 and we got two of the three dojos, I think, at this point in the battlefield. Or in the battle.
Yeah. And again, you've just gone and chased off his bows again, and they're getting just decimated.
Yeah, because I have some light cav just kind of sitting there to, basically keep your opponent kind of having to micromanage things. I mean, it's, micromanaging is such a huge part. And then, I put the Daikus over in the woods over there to give them some better, protection. I mean, maybe they won't be as accurate shooting out of the woods, but at least those foot samurai won't, have a good way of hitting them through the trees.
Exactly. So now he's, my opponent's finally bringing more of his bows forward. And I'm just happy, I'll just come back a bit. I'll let you gain a little bit of ground. We're gonna try to keep you from getting the sword dojo, whether it's with cavalry or just a straight out infantry charge, but perfectly happy to skirmish with your bow, Ashigaru, and beat them. And is Foxhounder moving out now? I think Foxhounder's moving up on you. Is this what? Oh yeah.
Yeah, they're finally
volley into his infantry.
Yeah, I mean, having just the Daikus hit some of the Yari samurai or any of the spear units is really, really helpful. Especially for armies like mine that are, hammer and anvil heavy types. And I mean, again, our opponents really, that, you know, finally Mr. Platypus decides to, you know, make a decision to start moving forward, and by then, you know, it's already too late, you know, at that point in the battlefield. And you know, we're both just content to, you know, harass with cavalry and everything and bide our time and be patient.
So this unit here has run out of ammunition. And I'm perfectly happy at this point because I did do an ammunition upgrade on this bow samurai. So I'm perfectly happy at this point because why send a unit of Yari samurai? Even though I could, I'm going to send these guys in to screen. They're going to be my first line of infantry to go in and take all of the matchlocks and all of the arrows they can. And then I'm going to send in my attendants. If I have any. Yeah, I'm going to send my attendants and those empty bow samurai as my first line of infantry with my swords right behind. Because, I mean, bow samurai are not great in melee, but they're okay. They can usually hold their ground against light cav if they get a charge and don't rout right away. But they're good just for taking arrows. When they've run out of ammunition, they're now a throwaway unit. Instead of having to screen with, you know, one of my samurai or a hero unit, I can screen with just an empty bow. And I'm perfectly happy to do that. Oh, you've caught his cav here. Nicely done.
Yeah, pretty much just waited for some committal here and really wanted to protect the sword dojo, obviously, since, you know, you have a katana-based army, and really it would be beneficial. And sure, I take some bullets here, but, you know, they can't shoot all of it. And so I just use one of my cav to screen my other cav.
Yep.
Towards those matchlocks. And if you look, all those spears and all those infantry units are in the front line, and look what's in the back, just all missile units. And pretty much it's just also a free range to attack the general.
Yeah, and his general's really far behind here, which is not a good place. And say I do the same thing here, I send one unit of light cav into screen, I've got another one.
Our men are running from the battlefield! Shameful display!
These guys, I'm trying to get to the matchlocks, but I end up getting stopped by these, but...
Yeah, but as long as you get the matchlocks to shoot a volley off, the time they have to take to reload is enough to maybe catch them in time, or exactly. Other things like that, especially with the way in which... As long as the matchlock user know, if they know how to use them well, then it can be, you know, dangerous, but...
Exactly.
At the same time, yeah, you know, you see the cavalry fight in the back with... Just swarm his general. And if I can take out his general, then all these units will rout a lot quicker.
Exactly, especially the Ashigaru. Because they already mm-hmm. have weak morale. And that's the thing, too. Like, your general has an influence radius around him, and if you are far enough away from your army, they will rout faster. Even if your general's alive, they will still rout quickly. So, unless you have a lot of high-ranking veterans with morale bonuses, and you're using a morale retainer or two, you want to stick your general as close as you can, safely, to your infantry. Otherwise, they will rout quickly. Like, already their morale is low. You just killed their general. You're in behind them. Right now, you're just doing mop-up. You're being the hammer to my anvil right here.
Yeah, I mean, again, you know, this is 2v2 or, you know, 3v3, 4v4. If you can help out your teammates, the more likely you are to succeed. And so that's, you know... Cavalry's a really great way of doing that. They're really mobile and quick, and yeah, protect your general at all costs in any Total War game, but especially in Shogun 2, because morale is so crucial to the battle. And going back to the you know, point about the bow samurai and sending them as screens, you know, one of the biggest things is like absorbing the charge of yep. enemy, you know, infantry units, so that your infantry units can get into the battle later, less exhausted and fatigued, and fresh to basically cut them down as they're stuck.
Exactly. And without the morale shock of taking a charge. Exactly.
Right, right.
And
or the ability to flank too, which, yeah. you know,
and,
is also a thing.
You know, I think this Katana Samurai at this point would have probably been better served coming in to engage my infantry instead of coming up on the hill to get my bows, which at this point are basically there just for distraction. They're not going to be doing much other than literally as he did here, sending a unit away from his main line of infantry to attack my bows, which are no longer going to be the determining factor for the army or for the battle. The infantry that I had was what was going to win it for me. Everything else was there to support it. And then over here, you've so we're mopping up on my side. Over here, you've thoroughly engaged
Yeah, this is this is pretty much a lesson in well, there's two things really: local superiority and force concentration. I put all my fodder units on one side to hold one flank in which all these foot samurai are shooting at, and then I send, you know, all my other units, my really, you know, where the money of my army is in, and I concentrate their force together, and then, you know, I have local superiority because there's just more of my men in the area, and I just overwhelm the front line, really. And of course, the monks help with that a lot with the war cry, but even then, you know, I'm fighting Ashigaru and Yari samurai and everything, yep. And I have a cavalry, an extra light cav over there to, you know, circle around for a mini hammer and anvil, and of course my cavalry's rushing from the other side of the battlefield. But yeah, I mean, the ability for those Naginata attendants and those Yari samurai just to hold there for that long was able, you know, splitting up my opponents, split up their forces, and that really, you know,
and you just routed the entire front line. And that's the thing too, when you're using monks, you want to time the war cry. You don't want to do it right away. You want to do it when the morale bar for your opponent is down in the yellow and red. That's the best time. Oh, nice charge on running Ashigaru, and you still get the general.
And again, you know, even, you know, the light cav is such a cheap unit that even if they get caught by spears, you know, cavalry doesn't really get stopped all the time. You can sometimes pull them through to get to a general, but yeah, I mean, here I'm able to circle back some of my forces to deal with those remaining men. But you know, if I'm able to kill my opponent's general, then the morale won't matter, and of course I get the archers up on the top there with some cav coming that way. And of course you've now fully mocked up that section and are rushing over with your full army.
just in case.
Yeah, I don't give you the chance to come over and help me. But you were like, let me get over there.
Yeah, it's like, I'm coming. And you're like, no, I'm good. So, but I did get you back on that because you were trying. We were doing a 3v2, and you were like, "I'm coming to help you." And I'm like, "No, I'm good. I'm taking two guys."
Oh no! Yeah. It's we'll have that video up soon.
But this. This is. I guess you would call this almost a defeat in detail. Like.
Yeah, this would be kind of a little bit of a defeat in detail in that I split up my opponent's forces. You know, I want my opponent to split his army in half. I defeat one half and then the other half. You know, don't really try to take on your opponent on all sides. But again, you know, the concept of just having more bodies in an area, in a vicinity, when it comes to Shogun 2 is really crucial for morale. And I mean, it's the same thing with your side, you know, having, you know, your opponent sending those katanas up that hill, kind of, you know, chasing archers. It's like you gotta keep your spear, you know, if you can keep as many units together fighting in unison, that will always guarantee a better chance of victory.
Anyways, I don't know. Do you have any thoughts to add? I think that was just about covered it, but if you have something to add, please do.
No, that's said well. All I have to say is, and this will be my last little thing, is thank you all for watching, and please check out more of our, we'll have more of these videos like this in the future.
Perfect. See you guys around.